please stand? Congregation may be seated, and welcome to our worship today in loving memory of the brother of all of us in Christ, Steve Foster. Let me introduce myself. I'm Craig Schinnerer. I am the pastor, a transition pastor here at St. Paul. I've been here over a year and am blessed to have ministered to this family, even more to be ministered to by them. Also with us is Reverend Pastor Andy Whaley, pastor at Water's Edge Lutheran Church in Frisco, formerly here with a long relationship with this family. I will share with you as an introduction today, the title I often use for worship like this, a celebration of grace and resurrection in Jesus Christ in loving memory of Steve Foster. It is so important to remember God's grace, not our works or anything we or he did, but totally by grace we are saved. And resurrection, we have an answer for death in the risen Lord. In fact, I'd like to read to you the introduction I often put in bulletins. Summarizing a bit, we gather today to worship the risen Christ, to celebrate the sure and certain hope of eternal life which all have who trust in him as their Savior. We share today the promises of his word for our forgiveness, peace, and glory. We speak before him and to each other the words of our faith. We raise to him our songs and prayers of thanksgiving and petition. We gather today to be turned again, as we must always, from the sin and mortality of our flesh to the grace and the life of Jesus Christ. So please join with full heart and voice in worship today. Colossians chapter 3, verse 2. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. Please stand for our opening invocation in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We tried to research the exact date, but could not find it. Calling churches in Oline, Iowa, Peace Lutheran, I think it was, Zion Lutheran. Jane shared that Steve was baptized as an infant, confirmed later as a teenager in Des Moines. And that's important because Steve died long before February 19th, and all of us who are baptized have. Our sin and damnation was buried at the cross, and a new creature comes forth. Paul says it this way, Romans 6, do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. I didn't hear the arrangements from Jane or Jody. Are we standing or sitting for the opening song? Standing. Stay standing to sing.
Consider all the words thy hand hath made. mercy and peace to you from God our Father, from our resurrected Savior Jesus Christ, and from that powerful Holy Spirit that lives and dwells within each and every baptized believer of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You can be seated if you can, but hopefully this will get you on your feet a little bit. Spending time with Steve Foster got me on my feet. He got me excited to be around him, and I'm privileged this morning to be able to share the message about his life. Pastor Craig, from baptism until the day that he died, Psalm 23 was inside of the heart of Steve Foster. Jesus was his shepherd, leading him all the way, especially at the end. Jane has asked me this morning if I would preach on 1 Timothy 6, 11 through 14, and that the title of the sermon would be, He Fought the Good Fight. Jane, he did indeed, but I thought I might just call this message, My Friend Steve, if that's okay with you. 1 Timothy 6, 11 through 14 says, But you, man of God, there we are. Steve Foster was a man of God. God was alive in his heart, put there by his Son, Jesus Christ, and his Holy Spirit, through water and the Word, and through his entire life. Steve Foster had Jesus alive in him because of God's gift. But you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. And we have several rows of family here that can account and attest today that that is the way that Steve lived his life most of the time. Most of the time. Every now and then a father must have a firm hand. A grandfather must tell a son or a daughter, what are you doing with your grandkids? And Steve was pretty good at that too, I think. Fight the good fight of faith. That's the fight that Steve fought. It wasn't anything, as Pastor Craig said, that was under Steve's own strength or by his own power, but Steve fought the good fight of faith. And today we come and we celebrate the fact that Steve is reaping the benefits of faith in Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and he has done that. He's holding firm to the eternal life which was given to him today. Are you taking hold of it? It's been given to you. God's word has been poured out to you by many, but for so many of us here today, by Steve Foster. We heard God's word through his mouth. We knew of the eternal salvation that he was grabbing hold of so firmly, and we grab a hold of it ourselves. Grab tight to that same faith. When you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses, and oh my goodness, did Steve Foster not make his confession, both good and bad, in front of many witnesses time and time again. The life that we lead in Jesus Christ is a life of constant repentance, asking God to forgive us of our sins, bring up the new man in Christ once again, and march us out the door differently than we did when we got up in the morning and Steve lived a life of repentance. In the sight of God who gives life to everything, not just life in this life, but because of his Son, Jesus Christ, he gives life after this one. Please remember that tomorrow is Palm Sunday, which inaugurates and kicks off Holy Week, the week that we celebrate as most holy in the church, because that's the week that God's Son, Jesus Christ, went to the cross for your sins and rose out of an empty tomb 3 days later so that he could walk directly into Steve Foster's life, make his home in his heart so that his living Holy Spirit might lead him forward until the day he died and what? And beyond. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. In the sight of God who gives life to everything, and of Jesus Christ, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate this coming Friday, made the good confession himself. See, Steve wasn't the first one to make the confession. Jesus was. Jesus passed it on to many of his disciples. We're going to hear that in just a second. Specifically, the guy that wrote this letter, 1 Timothy. This is the Apostle Paul, who was once murdering Christians for believing in Jesus Christ. He runs into Jesus himself on the road to Damascus, has a life-changing conversion and experience where now he is filled with faith. He's baptized, and the rest of his life, he can only do one thing. He can only proclaim the name of Jesus. And he's proclaiming that name and that life to his buddy Timothy, a younger man who's becoming a pastor. And Paul is training him up in the way that he should go, in the way that he should lead people. And Steve trained up Dave, Linda, and Toby, and the rest of their family in the way that they should follow after Jesus Christ. So Jesus made the good confession about his Father in heaven and about himself. He passed that on to Paul. Paul passed that on to Timothy. Timothy passed that on to Steve. Steve passed it on to everybody in here, but especially his family. Keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. But before diving right into the text, you might have thought I already did that, Dave. Dave's been to one or two of my sermons recently. I promised to hold this to 90 minutes, everybody.
Don't take my time, Pastor.
Yeah. But what I wanted to start with today is by thanking Jane, Dave, Toby, Linda, and the entire Foster clan for allowing me the privilege of sharing with you a message of joy and hope about my dear friend, my brother in Christ, Steve Foster. And I want to specifically just share five things in particular that Steve and I are both very passionate about. It's my hope that as I share my list with you today, there are many more thoughts of the passions that you shared with Steve, and that they'll come to mind also, and they'll bring not just a tear, but a really big smile on your face. To begin, you may not know this, but Steve and I both share a passion for Christmas, and especially for the role that Santa Claus plays in the imagination of young and old alike. Did everybody in here know that? Steve was, for many years, Santa Claus here at St. Paul, especially during Journey to the Manger. And I want to share this story. I've shared it with Jane. It's a special one for me and my wife, Jen, and especially for our son, Sam. Steve was Santa Claus to our son. Right? And there are probably many other people in here that Steve was Santa Claus to their kid. Steve left an indelible mark, an impression on Sam of who Santa is and how he acts, especially his warmth and his kindness toward children. And as parents, that was special for Jen and for me. You see, Sam, like so many other little ones, loved Santa from afar, and especially seeing him on TV, and the hope that he would show up at our house in the middle of the night while he was asleep, but he sure didn't want to have to come face-to-face with him. Anybody have any kids like that? Oh, I want to go see Santa, and you take them to that moment. They finally get to sit on Santa's lap, and all of a sudden, we didn't know whose demon child it was, but we told everybody it wasn't ours. For everybody but Steve. Did you know that, Jane? Try not to tear up. Steve was the only Santa on whose lap Sam sat quietly, lovingly look up at him while Steve was talking to him. Sam never sat on another Santa lap again. To this day, when I remember Steve, I remember how passionate we both were about Christmas, and I remember that he's my son Santa. Steve and I both have a deep passion for the great game of, say it, baseball. A very deep passion. Actually, I just drove from Highland Park from a high school baseball game to be here with you today, and I think Steve's extremely happy. The boys got a win, so that's good. As many of you are quite aware, with your favorite sports teams represented today, so many wearing them, I thought, better side of valor to wear a suit today with Pastor Craig. But I brought my jersey, and I was hoping maybe for the first time ever in the middle of a memorial service to get a boo from some of the Foster family. I brought my Allen Eagles jersey that my son wore and hoped maybe I'd get some Plano and some Little Elm boos. Kevin, how we doing? Good. But as Cole shared, that's not such a big deal. I didn't bring Alabama, which I can't stand either, Cole, so that probably would have got a bigger boo. Steve and I both loved baseball. We loved watching kids play baseball. Steve loved watching his grandsons play baseball. And he loved, did you know, watching my son play baseball. He loved watching my son play baseball. Who is this guy? Do you know how challenging it can be to get my own folks out to watch Sam's game sometimes? And here's Steve chasing me down. I need to get the Allen Eagles calendar and see where Sam's going to be playing in Allen. And that's currently my favorite sports team, and I think it's Steve's too. Here's where the boo may come in. Did you know that the last live high school baseball game that Steve attended was an Allen Eagle high school baseball game? Hey, up! And it was a blessing. Steve and Jane came, and Steve was not actually doing well at the time, and you could see the concern on Jane's face, and face and what a big deal it was for Steve to be out and about and with friends and how baseball just brought him to life. And Sam that day hit a double to right center field. Amazing. Jen and I looked at each other, and then we looked down at Steve, and we said, that was for Steve. And there was Steve shouting louder than anybody, louder than anyone. And what I loved most about that moment was Jane just watching Steve cheer. And the joy that that brought to your heart and the joy that it brings to you today, remembering that Steve loved watching people play baseball. I love to spend that time with Steve and Jane together, especially this past fall. I'll miss it. I will. I've talked oftentimes to my brother Dave that he's walking in shoes and taking footsteps before me that I'm not ready to take. And it'll be a hard day when it comes. Thanks, Dave. I hope and pray that all of you know that Steve shared a deep passion for his family. Anybody doubt that at all? But what you may not know is I share a deep passion for Steve's family. I am intimately involved with Steve's family in so many different ways, and that's really why it's a blessing to be here. It's because of Steve and Jane and the love that they had for one another. I remember redoing your vows for your 50-year anniversary in your backyard and everything that that meant and showing Jen and I what a marriage should look like, what a marriage should be like, how a marriage should stand the test of time because Jesus is at the middle. And it's because of your love for one another, Jane, with Steve, and knowing that you are deeply loved by Jesus, that you pass that love on to each and everyone in here. Look at each other, especially the Foster family. Steve passed the love of Jesus Christ on to Jane. Jane looked back in his eyes and passed it back. And then the two of them looked at each and every one of you, and they gave you every bit of love that they have. Steve loved till the very end. He fought a good fight to the very end, not for himself, but because he didn't want any of you to hurt. What a blessing. It's through that so many of you sitting here today that Jen and I are blessed to count. I'm looking at the front row, and I got two of my best friends. I got another mom, who, by the way, says that I'm the best son. You do. But these are brothers and sisters in Christ. They are confidants. They are accountability partners. And they are prayer warriors in Jen and I's life because of Steve and Jane. And we are so thankful for the way that Steve led his family because now it's leading ours. Basically, so many members of this family are some of the most important people in my life and in my family. And I hope they remain some of the most important people in yours. Third, and of course, I share a deep passion of faith in Jesus Christ, which should be right in the middle of the five things, which is the reason we are here today to celebrate Steve's life, his legacy of faith, and to celebrate it according to 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18, that we are not here to mourn as those who have no hope. We are not just here to cry and to be bereaved and to grieve. But instead, we're here to laugh, to smile, and to celebrate because Jesus's resurrection is alive in Steve today, and Steve believed that that's what we would be talking about right now. This is indeed, as it says in your bulletin, a celebration of life because Steve is not dead. He is in the resurrection with Jesus Christ. One of my favorite passages from Scripture comes from the Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus takes Peter, James, and John up the mountaintop. And as they're up there, Jesus turns into my favorite. If you're from the South, this is one of my favorite things that you can hear in the Bible. Jesus becomes like white lightning. And he becomes bright. And Peter, James, and John are stunned. And then all of a sudden, standing there next to Jesus is who? Moses and Elijah. And what's amazing is Peter, James, and John, hundreds of years removed, who have never met them and never seen them, know who they are. They know him by face because when we are resurrected and we are face to face with Jesus, guess who we will be with? We will be with Steve. We will be with Kate. We will be with all who have gone before us in the faith. And who would not want that blessed gift of our Father in heaven through his Son, Jesus Christ, to not be reunited with all those that you love? This is the faith that we celebrate today that was alive in Steve. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. This brings me to the passion that Steve and I share regarding words and the beautiful place they hold in our lives. Steve and I were both writers. We talked about what we wrote over the years, and at times I would share with Steve some of the short stories that I was writing. The indelible character right after the Civil War, a Southern Baptist preacher in Louisiana from Houma named Beauregard Spitzalot, who was my alter ego, although Jen says it sounds a lot like me. Beauregard Spitzalot would have people bring blankets and towels that sat in the front row because he was so excited about proclaiming the name of Jesus to everyone. And as I shared my short stories with Steve, and he would critique them every now and then, he shared with me some of his poetry, the maturity, the thoughtfulness, the life experience that were expressed in his poetry meant a lot to me and helped me to grow as a man. So much so that I asked Steve to write a particular poem and share it in front of the congregation during a sermon series that I was preaching on from the Old Testament prophecy of Joel and its fulfillment at the coming of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit poured out on God's people, and that promise not only to young men and to young children, but to old men, just like Steve. And that's the poem that's on the back of your service bulletin. Steve read this poem during the middle of one of my sermons, a poem that expresses the faithful dreams of an older man coming to terms with the latter years of his life, and yet the purpose for which God was still acting through him until the day that he went to be with Jesus. Why don't we hear about Steve's faith from his own words? Dreams of what was, what is, and what will be. Of youthful strength and vigor I no longer see. Now it's knowledge and maturity which grow each day, and loving thoughts for my family as they worship and pray. I dream for them all. And he's dreaming for you still. I dream for them all a good earthly life of great health and happiness and very little strife. To enjoy their lives while we observe the many seeds we sow. To watch my children and theirs as they learn and grow. Steve was a man that never stopped learning and never stopped growing. That they know God's word is a blessing to share, to give with their hearts to all who need care. To give of myself to those who need strength, to know that the love we share has an endless length. He knew. He knew about the resurrection. He knew about what life on the new earth would be. It would be of endless length. I dream that my earthly days will be good and long as my love for God and family remains so strong. But most of all, dream of what will be when at last my Savior I finally see. What a blessing it is to sit here today and to know that the patriarch of your family's dreams came true and he is face to face with Jesus Christ today. To see once again my earthly dad, whose early passing left us all so sad. From the boundless mercy received in God's love, I reached the joy of eternal life as guaranteed from him above. And that's Steve. This poem could only be written by a baptized believer in Jesus Christ who knew of the resurrection, one who had received the gift of faith, the forgiveness of sins, and the promised salvation that we will witness once again this coming week as Jesus marches to the cross and through the empty tomb. And that's exactly what 1 Timothy 6:11 through 14 is all about. Paul's charge to Timothy to fight the good fight of faith in Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit, which is solely founded on the good fight that Jesus fought for you and me on the cross. The good fight of faith was introduced to Paul on the road to Damascus by Jesus himself. Paul then takes that charge, this gift of faith, and passes it not only on to Timothy as of first importance, but he makes the same charge to Steve. And Steve is making that same charge through his poem today. Make no mistake that he's passed on his faith to you and to me. It is the legacy of faith in Jesus Christ that we celebrate. For Steve has taken hold of the eternal life given to him by Jesus himself. There are now nail-scarred hands that hold him. Jane, to wrap up and to share with everyone, probably something that maybe you don't remember, but I wanted to remind you and encourage you especially of this truth, that it's not just Steve's faith, but this is the faith that you shared as a couple. This gospel from the last paragraph of a letter you wrote to me on August 22nd from 2007. I want you to hear the words that you wrote. Many years later, God kept his promise, and his son was born in the image of himself. He was God-man named Jesus Christ. When Jesus grew up, he moved around the country teaching the word of God. He performed miracles just enough to show that he was the Son of God and that he was supreme over all things. Then he was nailed to a cross, died, and rose from the dead. This was God's plan to save all people from their sins. People who believed in him would now have everlasting life. Christians were now complete. Christ had triumphed over the devil and sins were forgiven. Adam at one time had introduced sin and death into the world, but Christ now brought righteousness and new life. Christ made peace between God and humans. Our personal union with Christ is the reality of our salvation. In a note at the very bottom, Pastor Andy, did I get that right? Steve got it right, and so did you, Jane. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. We're going to have an opportunity now for a moment of silence to watch a slideshow of Steve and his life. Well, we're blessed with the opportunity now for Steve's grandchildren to come up, and sons and grandchildren, I'm sorry, family members, that are going to come up and share specific thoughts that they have of Steve and also some verses. We have some microphones that are up front. So if you guys want to all come up, and then you guys can go one at a time. Was this an order in particular, Jane, that you wanted them to come in? Okay. Toby, they got you first. Yeah, yeah. The green light, Toby.
Well, it doesn't help. My phone's just died, so. Well, first of all, I'd like to just thank everybody who showed up today. I know we have a lot of family members that came from some distance, you know, from Washington, from Arizona, from Florida, from, I'm sure there's some other towns, California, North Carolina, you know, New Mexico, Dallas, you know, Allen, Little Elm. And, you know, I came the furthest away. I live right across the street. So, but I really appreciate seeing all these family members and friends who love Steve so much. And before I introduce the grandkids, I got to keep it short because otherwise I'll get sloppy. You know, I just want to mention I was out to dinner with my friends, you know, Michael, Timmy, Casey, and Robert. We go out to dinner, you know, once every month or two. And we just talked about anyways, I was much better at the wedding, I think. We just talked about how, you know, Steve was always there, and we always loved to share the stories about, you know, Grandpa Steve being at all the football practices, you know. You know, we always wondered, you know, if Steve had a job, because Steve was 2:30 in the afternoon, he's sitting there watching us practice, and it was always the story, all the players always asked, hey, who's that big guy over there, you know. You know, I used to always say he's a football scout for somebody. You know, I don't know, but you know, it was great to always have Steve there. I know he was at every practice for Dave and, you know, Linda, and of course, you know, for me at Plano East. But you know, I just appreciate all those kind words my friends had to say about Grandpa Steve, and how they always were invited to come to the house. And you know, Tim used to always mention he got in trouble if he came to the house and he knocked on the door. You go, Timmy, just come in, you know. And so, but, you know, thank you for being here, guys. I can do is smile when I think of my dad, and I miss him so much. And so, let me go ahead and introduce Corbin, Caden, Cole, and great, what? Not yet? Who's Foster? Okay, I don't know, y'all. Come on up. Whoever wants to go next.
You can hold that one. I'll hold this one. Hello, everyone. Oh, wow. Okay. My name is Foster Wiley. Steve's youngest grandchild. I really could. Wow, I'm more nervous than I thought I was going to be. But I could truly just write a book over the things that our grandpas taught me over our life. Steve was one of my best friends and my greatest teacher. And some of the things that he taught me was how to be a great husband, father, businessman, leader of a family. I think the greatest lesson that he taught me was how to have a foundation in Jesus Christ in a fallen world. And if I could be an ounce of what he was, then I'm doing something right, because he did a whole lot right. And my favorite verse is Micah 6:8, solely because of Jan and Steve. And it says, Know, O people, the Lord has told me you what is good, and that what is that this is what he requires of you, to do what is right, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. And I can say with full confidence that I saw Steve live that out every day of his life, and that there was not a single day that I didn't see him actively living that. And so I just wanted to close with one more verse. It's Luke 23:42-43. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus replied, I assure you, today you'll be with me in paradise. And so I know it's hard and it's sad here, but that today can be a day of celebration because Steve is in paradise with our Savior. And I know our grandpa may be dead on this earth, but he's never been more alive. And Gramps, I love you, and I miss you, and I can't wait till I see you in heaven when you're not just my grandpa, but my brother in Jesus Christ. Thank you. God, I hate Foster. We love and hate Foster, but that's what sucks about following him. Oh, Lord. I'm going to try to get through this, but we'll see if I can. I'll try not to be monotone, but we all have great memories of Steve, and like, I think the generic one is how, like, Steve would never miss a game and how he would be all of our biggest fans. But at the end of the day, I think I was Steve's biggest fan. So I've been in Arizona, and when Steve passed away, I was having a hard time thinking of what memory and story I wanted to share with him. And so about 2 weeks ago, I was at a Walmart, and I saw a man with his elderly mother in Walmart. And for some reason, it instantly made me think of how Steve was always there for Granny. And this is where it begins. For those of you who don't know, Grandpa Steve and Jane would take me to school every day, whether it was hitting a curb or asking me how my day was or telling me a Jesus story. But so after school, Steve would pick me up, and we would go to Spring Creek Gardens, which is where Granny would live. And we knew that place inside and out, and I felt like I was basically another staff member because I knew every code, every door. And I knew where which people were supposed to be at and exactly which room Granny was in. And most importantly, me and Steve would watch Granny, or me, Steve, and Granny would have the best view to watch all the alligators outside Granny's window. For those of you who don't know, Granny would call the birds and squirrels alligators. I'll forever be grateful for the times we had at Spring Creek Gardens, but lastly, I'll forever be grateful for the lessons I've learned from you and how to love my future family the way that you did. I love you, Grandpa.
Hi, everyone. If you don't know me, I'm Steve's favorite granddaughter. Throughout the 23 years I got with Steve, he taught me a few things. He taught me how to swim in the pool at the McCarta house, which holds some of my favorite memories with him. He taught me how to properly roll Pillsbury Crescent Rolls for any holiday because that was the only type allowed in the house. He taught me how to put my money in CDs and Roth IRA so I can retire early like he did. Most of all, he taught me how to welcome and invite people into our home no matter what. He showed me how we can love others tremendously by just showing them kindness, whether that is through a good meal he cooked, quality time, or again, just showing up. He showed me so much love despite being the only grandchild who didn't play baseball. Instead, that love was shown through coming to all my volleyball tournaments, driving back and forth to pick me and Foster up over summers throughout school year, and attempting to teach me to play bridge, which unfortunately didn't stick. However, my favorite memories of him showing me his love is when Christmas rolled around and all of us grandchildren would get the same thing, like body wash, baby powder, toothpaste. But when we all opened up the gifts, mine was a little different, because while the boys got the generic brand like Equate, I got the name brand. He had the gift of making me feel valued and loved, and he had the gift of making me feel like name brand. I am thankful for the 23 years that I got to spend with one of my favorite people ever, and can't wait to see him in paradise one day.
Grandpa Steve, about a month now, and all I do at the beginning and end of each day is think of my gramps, seeing that iconic nosedive he'd make in Grammy Jane's pool, the countless games where you'd see an old man in a lawn chair, a cooler, and a radio listening to whatever local team was on play that day, or the after-school fast food trips we'd make with whatever coupons we could scrape together. It's still so hard to imagine my gramps is gone. He's been here for it all, helping each of us grandchildren grow up, from moving out to moving back in to getting a job to enrolling into school to graduating college to getting married, and most recently being there on the day Elizabeth and I found out we were having a baby. I had a conversation with him a while ago that I'll never forget. We were on a call, and he went on about how family was just so much fun. Knowing that as life happens, families move and grow. However, we always make our way back together. Because these are the memories we'll want. These are the memories we'll want more of. Thank you, Grandpa Steve.
My very good friend, Dave Foster, up front. Dave would like to take the opportunity to be able to share a few words about your dad.
I don't think I need that.
You need a mic.
I do need a mic.
Yeah, they won't be able to hear you. Here you go. Oh, will it? Okay. Oh, there you go.
Nice. It's a crowd I can work with. Sister said it best. If you know who I am, you know my family. I've been mentioned a couple times what a great businessman my dad was. He was the best. He taught me how to negotiate, a skill I didn't think I'd need today, but when I told Mom I needed an hour today, she told me I had 5 minutes. And I said, all right, I can do this in 30. And she goes, you're down to 2. Didn't think Dad taught her how to negotiate as well. They say death is a wound for the living. But when you read Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. As a family, we take such great joy in that. Before Dad was in Catherine's womb, Lord Jesus knew his name. Hallelujah. Disease and old age have a way of diminishing a man's legacy. Not Steve Foster. Dad lived. He was athletic. Y'all saw he was a good-looking dude. He loved a budget, a skill he did not pass on to his kids. Dad loved the music of Garth Brooks. He was successful in every silo of his life. He loved sports. Dad loved a good deal. Every summer I'd complain to Dad that the hotels in Vegas were so expensive. And he'd send me a text message I could stay at the Circus for $39. But Dad forgave. God, Dad forgave. Dad was the best businessman I ever met in my life. And I was blessed to call that same guy my father. Dad lived in that Coliseum every day where you're judged by your wins and losses, your defeats. Dad was a humble winner and a gracious loser. And he lived his life, business, and personal the same exact rule. Every day, just do the right thing. But we're not here to honor the businessman. We're here to honor the man that Dad was, the family man, the kingdom man, the man who loved his family, had a never-ending love for his wife. He's a protective brother, I hear irritating brother by my aunts, a proud uncle. Mom and Dad built a home of love and laughter and good food, inclusion. People didn't want to leave Mom and Dad's house. They never did. People know, they don't know what it is when you walk into a house full of love, but when you're in one, you don't want to leave it. Mom and Dad started early. We started humble. Not in a manger, but we started in a trailer in rural Iowa. No air condition, no bathroom. Dad, a 22 of two young boys. Shortly thereafter, a family of five when Linda came in. Mom, Dad was so young when he got married, he had to have Granny sign a certificate of approval. Mom was a teenage bride, a teenage mom. I know we're here to honor Steve Foster today, but Mom, it's for you. My mom, though. Every day that one day I'll work for Mom in the kingdom. What a kingdom leader you are. This lady was the hot den mother at Cub Scouts back in the day. Award-winning businesswoman in her own right and a successful entrepreneur. Well done, Mom. We were gypsies and we didn't know it when we were younger. We moved every 2 years. Packed up the Griswold station wagon, got the Mayflower van, and we're off to the next city every 2 years. We didn't know any different. It was an adventure. Mom and Dad didn't scare us. We were surrounded by love. We didn't know any better. The last move from Minnesota to Texas was the only one that was a challenge. I was already in high school, and we had established ourselves in the community in Minneapolis. On the drive down from Texas, me and the girls cried and cried. Dad tried to console us, and Toby wanted to know what all the fuss was about. Dad had a wicked sense of humor when we pulled into this dilapidated shack, and he goes, "Welcome home." We all started to wail. Even Toby cried. He realized his miscalculation when we got to our perfectly acceptable home. And said, "Get ready, we're gonna go to the nicest steakhouse in Texas." For a family that good eating was White Castle, we were fired up. And Dad didn't disappoint. That's a word, a phrase that rings true to Dad every day. Dad never disappointed. We walked into this mahogany, brown, dark steakhouse with the most beautiful salad bar you'd ever seen. We were at Steak and Ale. Man, we were high living. And before you know it, Dad's cracking jokes, Mom's giggling, and we didn't have a choice but laugh. And by the time we got home, we realized we were going to be okay. Fast forward to his mom's 80th birthday party, Granny's 80th birthday party, the matriarch of our family. And I wasn't on the committee that put together the surprise party. I think it was Dad, his sisters, maybe some cousins. And we all crammed into a suite at the Golden Nugget. Everyone, one of us had a granny in high school in a swimsuit. And when we got the word that Granny was there, we all hid, super smart, hide behind chairs, and when Granny walked in, we go, "Surprise!" Down goes Granny. Ambulance is there in a couple minutes. Why, Dad did not give me and my brother and sister the gift of budget. He gave us that gift of that ugly cry face. And Dad's just sitting in that suite going, "We killed Granny, we killed Granny." 2 hours later, Granny's hand is black from the penny slot machines. We were blessed to hear from 4 of the 5 grandkids today. Steve and Jane had a special, special relationship with their grandkids. When they started having grandbabies, they lived in Seattle. Thank you, Seattle family, for stealing Mom and Dad for as long as you did. Didn't know if I was jealous or pissed or happy about it, but He was yours for a while. By the time Grace came along, they had enough, and Dad went to the board of directors and said, I'm going to run the company in Texas, or I'm done. And so the company was in Seattle, and Dad ran the business from Texas. They moved 2 miles from three of their grandkids. And if you didn't have a special woman as a daughter-in-law, that wouldn't have been possible. Thank you, Kathy Foster. Thank you, Kevin Wiley, for the grace you gave Mom and Dad to be everyday grandparents. Not everyone does that. Thank you. Dad retired at 55 for a job well done. He didn't retire to open up a successful consulting practice, travel the world with his bride. He dug in to do the dirty work grandparents do. And he was there for the crap, and he was there for the good stuff. He was there for the forgiveness and for the endurance and love. Look around this room, and there must be 100 of you all that have celebrated a foster family Christmas, a Thanksgiving, and Easter. That house was full of love. That Christmas was just a microcosm of the love that family felt. Mom and Dad had made an art form out of wrapping toilet paper and regifting shaving cream. And that house was inclusive. We had family, we had extended family. We had strangers, we had people from church that had nowhere else to go. Dad had a joke with Mom. So first it started with his kids, and then he did to his in-laws, and then later his grandkids. Every Christmas, he would sneak in a present under the tree, and it was some inappropriate lingerie for Mom. And everyone would gross out except Mom and Dad, and they sat there, their own private joke, and just giggled and giggled. Did that every year I knew him. This last Christmas was a little different. Dad always made his famous chili. And everyone here knows that Big Steve made everything famous. Big Steve's famous ribeyes, famous pot roast, famous chili. He wasn't up for it this year. So we decided to do a new family tradition. Me and Toby had a chili cook-off. Toby cheated and he brought in Timmy. And we did a very public vote. But Dad was the ultimate judge, and I lost 15-13. But Dad wouldn't declare Toby and Timmy the winner. He took my chili and their chili, mixed it into a bowl, and said, that's the winner. Only Dad. Lastly, my last story. And I just heard the story for the first time weeks ago. Over the last year, we've been very intentional as a family to go visit Mom and Dad at their apartment as often as possible. And this was, it may have been 6 or 7 weeks ago. 12 of us are at Mom and Dad's on a late Friday afternoon. Next thing you know, it's me and Mom, Dad, and my buddy Russ. And I said, Dad, you want to go grab dinner? He said, let's go. Like, awesome. We went to a dinner. And it wasn't a sick old painful man that night. It was my dad. In the Hebrew language, tell me if I'm wrong, there's no word for coincidence in the language. So they don't believe in coincidence. They think everything's God. And that wasn't serendipity that night. That wasn't an accident. That wasn't luck. That was God's gift to our family. And as Dad told that story, he wasn't in pain. And he told me the first time he ever had a beer with his dad. Never heard that story before. Every man remembers the first beer they had with their pops. And as he's telling this story, as he tells this story, he's animated like he always used to be. And he's leaning into the story, and he's living it. He's there. They were living in Des Moines at the time. And him and his best friend were packing up his 57 Chevy, either go to a Cubs game or a Cardinals game, and I can't remember. And just then, Grandpa Dean rolled in from a night at the butcher shop and was covered in blood. And said, what are you doing, son? He goes, oh, we're on our way to the Cubs game, Dad. He goes, "That sounds fun. You want to invite your dad?" And his dad tells this story. His beautiful little beady blue eyes are dancing. And he said, "You want to go to the game with us, Dad?" And he said, "Let me go clean up, son." And just like that, dad and son and best friend are on their way to the Cubs game. They get to the Cubs game a little early, and Grandpa Dean looks at dad and says, "Son, did you pack any beer?" And dad can't get to the punchline because he's so into the story. And if you know my dad has the most genuine, unduplicated, charismatic, contagious laugh you ever heard in your life. And he's roaring at the table. And we're laughing. The table next to us laughing. This table's laughing. The waiters are laughing. And dad can't get out the punchline. And he gets there, and his daddy, and he's pantomiming, and I opened up the trunk, and he opens it up, and Grandpa Dean goes, "Son, why do you have so many beers?" He goes, "Dad, I didn't know how many it would take." He packed 144 bottles of beer. And I never heard that story until a few weeks ago. Thank you, Jesus. I can't be Pastor Craig. I can't be Pastor Andy. I'm not a theologian, but I believe in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, the Apostle Paul writes about his visit to heaven. He struggles, I think, to put into words he can articulate. The songs he heard, the beauty he saw, he can't do it because he's from here. He's trapped here. So if the Apostle Paul can't do it, I can't tell you where Dad is. But I do know this, that he's more alive today than any time in his life. Dad, we'll always love you. In life, you gave us a blueprint in how to live in life. And in death, you showed us grace and honor. There was no angel of death in that hospital room that night. There was only Lord Jesus. Goodbye, Dad.
We can go ahead. The next song really serves. Even Jane and I discussed this as our creed, that baptism creed sing. We want to stand and sing. Okay, I defer to you. Stand up and sing.
Thank you.
before our closing prayers and the benediction, last words I want you to hear from God himself, announcements. I know some didn't get a chance to sign the guest register. You can do that as you exit. If you are going to the reception, everyone's invited at Discovery. The book will be there, I presume, so they can even sign it there. Indeed, the family is leaving immediately for the reception, or somewhat immediately. We will not have a lot of fellowship after this. In fact, we've got another event in the building in an hour, so we need some parking spaces, I suppose. Join your hearts in prayer. I'll revise some that are in our book. They speak the fundamentals here. God of grace and mercy, we give you thanks for your loving kindness shown to Steve and to all who have finished their course in faith and rest from their labors. May we also be faithful unto death and receive the crown of life. God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ. Give to your church in heaven and on earth your light and peace. May we who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection die to sin and rise to newness of life. Give to the family of Steve and to all who mourn comfort in their grief and the sure confidence in your loving care, that casting their sorrow on you, they may always know the consolation of your love. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we can't understand, to believe and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Receive the benediction, Jane, especially you and your family and everyone. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Music. Loves me, yes.
Jesus loves me.